In the year 221, before Common Era, Yin Zheng, the king of Qin, conquered the six rival states and unified all under heaven. His accomplishment immortalized him in the annals of history as Qin Shi Huang, the first emperor of China. For centuries, through the Warring States period, various states had fought over the dominion of China. But Qin Shi Huang accomplished what his predecessors and rivals could only ever dream of, in the short span of a couple of decades. Despite his success in the battlefield, Yin Zheng was not a warrior. He was a builder, and he had created the most powerful war machine of the time, the state of Qin. To understand how this invincible war machine was created and how he conquered China, we need to go back to the beginning, to a time slightly before Yin Zheng's birth. This is a story of a random merchant who unwittingly laid the foundation of his success. Lü Buwei was a merchant from the state of Wei. He was really good at what he does, buying low and selling for a fortune. He is every reason why merchants are placed in the bottom rung of Confucian society. One day, when visiting Handan, the capital of the state of Zhao, and the cultural center of the period, he saw a pitiful-looking man among the crowd of glamorous citizens. To his surprise, that man turned out to be Prince Zizu of the state of Qin. He had been sent there as a political hostage, an insurance in case the state of Qin decided to attack Zhao. But since he is just the grandson of the current king, combined with the fact that his mother was a concubine and he had 20 other brothers, he is practically a disposable nobody. He barely had any value as a hostage, so that's why he was treated like dirt. On the opposite side of the road, Lü Buwei was moved by what he saw.
Oh boy, can I make money out of this?
Through his experience, Lü Buwei knew that if he invests in agriculture, he can make 10 times the profit. If he invests in pearl and jades, 100 times. But imagine, how much can he gain by investing in a prince? So Lü Buwei immediately befriended him, and from being friends, they quickly became co-conspirators. Lü Buwei promised the prince Zizu that he could make him the heir of the throne of Qin, and the prince promised to share the kingdom with him if he can deliver on his promise. Once he learned more about Zizu's predicament, Lü began to set his plan into motion and moved to Qin with his followers and gifts. Among the seven states, Qin was considered the most violent and looked down upon, because their customs were mixed with those of the Rong and the barbarians. But for the last few generations, the king of Qin had been reforming the state's policies and military. By then, they were considered as one of the most powerful states. And if they have not earned the other states' respect, then they would have earned their fear. Using his gifts as bribes, Liu was able to worm his way into the inner palace and convince Zizu's stepmother, the wife of the current crown prince, to form a coalition with Zizu and pick him as heir. Since she did not have a son of her own, she agreed. This is a long-term investment for Lü. It will take two generations before Zizu takes the throne. But as a seasoned businessman, he knew that great investments take time to bear fruit. Unfortunately, the wait is never easy, because he needs to keep his golden goose happy and safe until it can start laying golden eggs. When Lü was having Zizu over for a drink, the prince caught sight of the most gorgeous dancing girl he had ever seen, and he immediately asked for her hand in marriage. This infuriated Lü Buwei, because Zhao Ji is his girl, his concubine. But not wanting to lose his investment over a silly fallout, he gritted his teeth and gave them his blessing, while hiding the fact that she was already pregnant by him. In due time, she will give birth to a boy, and that boy's name is Yin Zheng, the future unifier of China. A few years later, Qin attacked Zhao, even with Zizu still being held hostage there. This just goes to show how expendable he was. But luckily for him, Liu Buwei got his back, and he is not going to let his cash cow die. So he bribed Zi Chu's guards with 600 caddies of gold, lots of money, and the two of them scooted out of there, abandoning his wife and baby. This is the kind of cavalier attitude the royal families have over their own family members. And this is the kind of experience that will harden Yin Zhen into the conqueror he will one day become. Fortunately, Zhao Ji came from a wealthy family, so she was able to hide out and survive. 6 years later, when the current king died and Zi Su became the crown prince, Zhao sent the mother and child back to Qin as a show of goodwill. Conveniently, Zi Su's father, the king, died after 1 year of rule, and this is when Liu Buwei starts to receive his dividends. The first thing his good old pal did when he became king was to make him the chancellor. He's rich, and things just keep getting better and better for him. Even more conveniently, 3 years after his rule, Zi Chu died, making the 13-year-old Yin Zhen the king. Obviously, now he had to look after the kingdom for the young, inexperienced king. So humbly, he took on the role of prime minister. He's got money, now he's got power. And even sex on the side, because he was having an affair with his old lover, Zhao Ji. What he is lacking now is influence and respect. Liu Buwei was a venture capitalist, and he knows how to invest in people. Ambitious people. He started to invite talented men into his household as live-in guests and promoted many of them to the court, strengthening his faction's influence. Some of these men were even intellectual heavyweights who would leave their mark in history, such as Li Si, who will one day be a steadfast pillar of Yin Zhen's regime. But that will be the story for the next episode. The next item on his bucket list is respect. With money, power and influence, he can buy respect easily. But he doesn't want to be just respected by the men of his time. He wants to be respected for posterity. So he commissioned his cohort of talented men to write an encyclopedia of all known knowledge, and named it, after himself of course. The book was said to be so perfect, he even displayed it to the public and challenged anyone to add or subtract any words to his perfect masterpiece for 1,000 gold. The book, called Master Lu's Spring and Autumn Annals, still exists today. And you know how grandiose he was because he called it Spring and Autumn. After Confucius's magnum opus, Spring and Autumn Annals. Practically, he considered himself to be Confucius's equal. Now, with all his desires fulfilled, all he's got left are worries. His secret affairs with Zhao Ji was turning into a liability. He couldn't risk everything he had accomplished for just one woman, so he gifted her with a boy toy, Lao Ai. And it was said that he was so virile he could hold up the wheel of a car with no hands. Well, that's one problem solved. But he will soon discover that the seeds of his own ruin has germinated. In 238 BCE, Yin Zhen reached adulthood, and it is time for him to consolidate his power. This young man's path to power was far from easy. Even before gaining official rule, he had to deal with the death of a trusted general, famine, and even a revolt by his very own brother. And he dealt with them with the utmost efficiency. On the first year of his official rule, he discovered that Lao Ai had been plotting a coup d'etat. So he called out all the remaining forces at hand and he crushed the opposition. Lao Ai was torn into two by carriages to serve as a warning to all who stood against him. Liu Buwei knew that he was in deep trouble now. It didn't take long for the king to discover that it was he who presented Lao Ai to the Queen Dowager. So he had to pull all of his strings to get out of this crisis. The MVPs were the talented men he had gathered over the years. They debated the king with such eloquence, his crime was reduced from death sentence to removal from office. Liu Buwei was sent away from the capital, but his influence did not wane. Talented men and officials continued to visit him. Upon realizing this, the king applied more pressure on him and sent him further and further away. Eventually, the repeated insult on Liu Buwei became too much, and he was driven to suicide. As for the Queen Dowager, she died the same year from an unknown cause. Progressively, Ying Zheng absorbed all of the talented people from the different factions and centralized power. With these obstacles out of the way, Ying Zheng prepares his war machine. For six generations, his predecessors has created the skeleton of a juggernaut that will tear through China. Liu Buwei had unwittingly gathered the talented men who will end up operating the Qin war machine. And now, the only thing that's missing is the operating system. Ying Zheng needed laws and national philosophy to run this monstrosity. On the next episode, we will cover legalism, the philosophy that conquered China, and we will take a close look at the man who became his architects of tyranny. So remember to subscribe, and I will see you on the next episode. In the meantime, stay cool, my bros!